See, the world says we think we're better than them. And what we should know and what I do know is I am not better than anyone else, but through the grace of God and the blood of Jesus, I'm way better than I used to be. Look at the person beside you and say, I'm getting gooder and gooder. I was praying for one of our teenagers at Children's Hospital the other day, and she looked up from the ICU, the intensive Christian ward, the unit, intensive Christian unit. And she said, Brother Perry, you need to work on your grammar. So I laid hands on her suddenly. And you know, I laid hands on her and prayed for her, and a lot of other people were praying for her, but you know, they had already completed a couple of tests and said they were confident there was an aneurysm. And then they sent her off to UMS so they could go in through the veins to put in a coil to deal with the aneurysm. But they didn't do that because when they got there, they checked out the test and they couldn't find the aneurysm. Come on, somebody. So I may not can speak English, but I know how to pray the prayer of faith. Everybody shout amen. So what's the true meaning of Christmas? Is it just all about the commercialization and even sharing our love and appreciation by giving of gifts, or even better, getting them? Don't you like getting gifts? Yeah, sure you do. Play all holy. All of a sudden you're like, oh, I don't want to say amen to that. Praise God. Amen. Yet you're already thinking, I wonder what I'm getting. With that attitude, sticks and coal in your sock. So you know what the Bible contains? The Bible contains the will of God. It informs us of the nature of man. It tells us the only way to salvation and a relationship with a holy God. And it tells us of the new life for every born-again believer. So when I read the scriptures, I want to know more than just a feel-good message, and I like those. I want more than just an inspirational message. I want more than a charismatic delivery from a charismatic preacher at some other church. What I want is the life-changing revelation of God that brings salvation and transformation into the hearts and lives of every believer. So how did it all begin? Now, I've got a lot to cover this morning. How did it all begin? Well, Genesis chapter 1 simply says this, and there's going to be a lot of shortcuts in the scripture today, so if you'll take good notes or go back and watch this on Facebook, this will help you. Number one, in the beginning, God created man and woman, and he blessed them. In the beginning, God created man in his image. Now, something way deeper than him did he create us just in his image. He created us with the ability to have fellowship with him, but he also created us with this infinite capacity to be God's residence, for him to live in each one of us. Wow. See, because he created us in his image, and God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, the triune God, created us a spirit living in a body, and we have a soul. And he created us to be able to somehow, miraculously, be the container, the reservoir, and the vessel of God to flow through. We're living in a generation that God's been kicked to the curb now for well over a generation. Now, so many individuals and groups have endeavored, because without God, somebody has to fill the void of God, and I believe it's called the God complex. We got to save the planet, got to save the animals, got to save the trees, got to save everything. But Jesus came to save you. The most important treasure on the planet is not the gold in them there hills or those diamonds down in Murfreesboro. It's you. And that Jesus came that we can have an eternal, intimate relationship with God. But see, what the devil did was sowed doubt. And so she took of the fruit and gave it to her husband who was with her. and he took of it. And that brings us to the prophecy of the serpent and the seed. In Genesis 3:14, it said, "The Lord God said to the serpent, 'Because you have done this, you'll be cursed above all cattle, every beast of the field, and upon your belly shall you go, and dust you shall eat all the days of your life.'" Devil, eat my dust. With the blood, we've been given authority over the devil. "And I will put enmity between you and the woman, and between your seed and her seed, and the seed of the woman shall bruise your head, and you will simply," added the word simply, "bruise his heel." Now Luther says this, he says, "This text embraces and comprehends within itself everything noble and glorious that is to be found anywhere in Scripture." Man, that's a mouthful. So let's look at that a little. This Scripture says that he shall bruise your head. See, God's plan, listen, God's plan was not setback. God knew well in advance. He knows the end from the beginning. He knew what the devil was up to. But see, God was interested in more than simply an innocent man and woman in the garden. God was interested in a redeemed man, a supernatural man, a man that could walk with God and talk with God and walk in authority and watch over God's things to guard it, protect it, take dominion and authority.
Have you ever considered a Christian education for your child? Then you should check out Arkansas Christian Academy, Saline County's fully accredited premier Christian school at an affordable family rate. Students have opportunities to excel in academics, athletics, fine arts, and technology. And through our dual enrollment program, high school students can even achieve an associate's degree prior to graduation. Visit us at ArkansasChristianAcademy.org.
See, God wanted more than just an innocent person. He wanted a redeemed one. God wasn't caught off guard. "Oh, what am I going to do? I didn't see that coming." See, Adam's sin allowed sin to enter the world. Romans 5 tells us this, that through one man's sin, sin entered, and therefore all men became sinners or received a sin nature. But through one man, Jesus Christ, all can be made righteous. Boy, that's a powerful statement. See, through the fall of Adam, through Adam's hearkening to his wife rather than obeying the voice of the Lord, because he listened to someone other than God. So you have a choice to make. You can listen to the world, or you can listen to God. You can respond to the world, or respond to his word. Darkness, deceit, defeat comes from listening to the world. Happiness, joy, peace, fulfillment, life, healing, salvation, deliverance comes from responding to his word. And Jesus is the living word of God. See, death came to all mankind, so that's a mess. And death reigned, past tense, over man. And Galatians tells us that the purpose of the law, that God called Moses the lawgiver, so the law could take us by the hand and show us of our desperate need for the grace and mercy of God that's only available through Jesus Christ to those who believe. But death reigned. See, in the book of Genesis, it covers over 2,000 years of human history. 20 generations. And yet the predominant character that we find about in the book of Genesis is this guy called Abram, who then has his name changed by God, Abraham. Why does God spend so much time with Abraham? See, here's what God did. God said, "You want to know what I'm up to? Watch this. Watch this." I want you to remember the title of the message is The Serpent and the Seed. Satan comes to steal, kill, and to destroy. So God says, I'm going to pick a guy. Now, I want you to notice with me in Joshua chapter 24, it shares about the heritage of Abraham that we pick up on in Genesis 11 and Genesis 12 and many of the subsequent verses and chapters. But here's what we find, that Abraham came from a family, a genealogy of idol worshipers. You know, when we study the scriptures, the thing that I really love about the scriptures is it shows us of this great grace and mercy of God. God uses the most unlikely people. Look at you. Look at me. He comes to this guy, Abram, who comes from a genealogy, a family legacy of idol worship. Yet God finds something about this man that he chooses to reveal the prophetic word of bruising Satan's head. Why does he choose Abraham? He could have chosen virtually anybody. You know, someone like you. David the adulterer. Samson. Remember? And Delilah. Someone like Moses, the murderer. Peter, the denier. Thomas, the doubter. Perhaps you didn't realize that the legacy that Abram came from was not what we understand him to become. A man of faith. A man who lived out the promise of God. And when we study Abraham, you know what we find? We find that Abraham made mistakes. In verse number 3 of Joshua 24, it says, I took your father Abraham from outside of the flood and led him throughout all the land of Canaan and multiplied his seed and gave him Isaac. Now just watch. You have Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Jacob is the supplanter. He's the con man. He's the manipulator, and yet his name is changed to Israel. Abraham believes God. God gives him a promise in Genesis 12. I want you to leave your home. I want you to travel. I'm going to show you a land that I'm going to give you. Abraham sets out. The Bible says, so Abraham departed. Abraham and Lot are traveling, and they separate because of confusion and dissension. Lot, worldly, carnal, moves down towards Sodom and Gomorrah. Boy, don't we know that story. Abram goes his own way. God says, see, as far as you can see, I'm going to give this to you and your seed. The seed, Genesis 21, 12, for in Isaac shall your seed be. There's something powerful in the kingdom of God in regards to the seed. Now, most of us have heard messages on seed, time, and harvest. You're hearing one now. But most of the time, we apply that to giving rather than to living. The greatest seed that you have is the seed of God's nature in you that enables you to live as a believer in divine authority in the earth. For in Isaac shall your seed be. So God says prophetically that Satan's head will be bruised in this conflict of the seed of the woman. God selects a man. That man departs in a journey of faith. Probably a very unlikely guy to be chosen. We see his mistakes. God doesn't even hide them from us. And as he's on this journey, he believes God. He receives a miracle son. And in Genesis 22, God said, I want you to give me your son. What? The son I've been believing for that you gave me, now you want me to give him to you? Can you imagine the conflict of the mind? See, most of us, we believe God for something, and then when we receive it, we think it's ours. You know, like the new birth. this new life. You're no longer your own. You just act like it sometimes and live like it sometimes and talk like it sometimes and walk like it sometimes. But we're no longer our own. We've been bought with a price. That's what that bread represented and that cup represented. Take your son, your only son, Isaac. You know, Isaac in whom the seed is? And he says, give me your son. Perhaps you've heard it said, when you let go of what God's given you, when you let go of what's in your hand, God lets go of what's in his hand. How do we get heaven into the earth? When we release it here in faith, God releases it there in promise. And so he's got the sacrifice, he's chopped the wood, they've loaded the donkeys, and his servants and his son are going. He gets to the foot of Mount Moriah, and he says, in Mount Moriah is where Solomon built the temple. He said, you guys stay here. Me and my son go up and give sacrifice,
and we'll be back.
Now, see, the story is he's going to sacrifice his son. But he said, wait here, we will be back. Hebrews says that Abraham believed God and considered his son Isaac already dead. And therefore, God said, well, there's nothing else necessary. But because he gave his son, God said, now I'm going to give you my son. I'm going to give you the seed, of the seed of the woman. That seed is not Isaac, it's Jesus. See, 1 Corinthians 15 says this in verse 45, the first man, Adam, was a living soul. The last Adam, Jesus, a quickening, life-giving spirit. Howbeit that was first, which is spiritual, but that which is natural, and after that which is spiritual. Isn't that how we started? We all started our life natural. We all started with a sin nature. But the moment we get born again, we become spiritual. Our old man is dead. We're crucified with Christ. Yet we live, yet not I, but Christ lives in me. See, the first man is of the earth. That's Adam. God created him out of the dust of the earth and breathed into his nostrils and become a living soul. But the second man, Jesus, is the Lord of heaven and the Lord of earth. Well, how do we get to the point where Satan, our arch enemy, our nemesis, where do we get to the place where he's defeated? Well, now this is the birth of Jesus Christ, Matthew 1. All of us know this story. We've heard it, most of us, since we were children growing up. Every Christmas we hear these verses, and therefore we don't listen to the Holy Spirit. Now the birth of Jesus was on this wise. His mother Mary, who was espoused or engaged to marry Joseph, before they came together, was found to be with child. Listen to this. She was found to be with child of the Holy Ghost. Now put yourself, ladies, in her position. She is with child, conceived of the Holy Ghost, and yet you're engaged to be married, and you've got to tell your fiancé, I know we've never been together, I know I've never been with a man, but I'm pregnant by the Holy Ghost. What do you think he would have thought? What do you think he was thinking? That which is conceived of her is of the Holy Ghost. So Joseph is really struggling with this. Now, I would like to note that though this would have been terribly traumatic, it was already prophesied in Scripture, starting in Genesis chapter 3. Again in Genesis 12 to Abraham, and again in chapter 13. Your children are going to be like the sands of the sea and the stars of the sky, and on and on and on it goes. Isaiah 7:14, a virgin shall be with child. Prophetically speaking the word. See, here's the thing. If you'll watch Abraham, you can see God moving to reveal his will for his seed. His name shall be Jesus. Jesus, Yahweh or Jehovah is my salvation. The song Noel. God incarnate. What does that mean, God incarnate? It means God in human flesh. Now think about that. If God, almighty, infinite, omnipotent, omniscient God, all-knowing, all-powerful, everywhere God, can be in Jesus in human flesh, who thought it not robbery to be equal with God, and Philippians tells us in chapter 2, then that tells us that you and I, as humans, created in God's image, can also be the temple or the residence of Almighty God. If it ever goes off in your spirit and your mind clicks into what the Spirit of God is saying, it'll revolutionize your life. You'll have a new understanding of the force of righteousness and the power of faith. Because no longer is God in some far off land with Oz, a yellow brick road. But Jesus came on a scarlet thread to live in each and every one of us. The seed of the woman, Jesus, who bruises the head of Satan. The devil's been defeated. See, Jesus meets us in our sin, but he loves us too much to leave us there. He comes to save us from the power of sin. Sin shall no longer have dominion. Sin shall no longer have dominion in your life. That's what Romans tells us. He comes to deliver us from the very presence of sin, because 2 Peter tells us that we've now escaped this world and its corruption through this exceeding great and precious promises. What's the great precious promise of God? The seed of the woman, the seed of Abraham, shall bruise the head of Satan.
Hey everybody, this is Pastor Perry right here at Destined Win TV and Second Chance Youth Ranch TV. And are you looking for an opportunity to change the world with your year-end giving and your tax-deductible receipt? Then why not consider Family Church Bryant, which is Destined Win TV, Second Chance Youth Ranch, or Arkansas Christian Academy. Every gift is changing the lives of somebody right here in the state of Arkansas. Thank you in advance for your kind support.
Now, Matthew 1:22 says, "Now all this was done, and it might be fulfilled, which was spoken by the prophet. Behold, a virgin shall be with child. Emmanuel shall be his name," interpreted God with us. Amazing. But there's a war going on between the serpent and the seed. We find that when Jesus was beginning, just prior to the beginning of his ministry, he's baptized by John in water, baptized in the Holy Ghost by God the Father. He comes up out of the water, and he's led immediately into the wilderness to be tempted of the devil. And we know the devil said repeatedly, "If you're the Son of God." How many times has he told you that? How many times has he asked you to question your own salvation? How many times has he said, "But there's no way you could be a Christian, not the way you act, not the way you talk, how few times you go to church and put up with Pastor Perry. And ain't no way, ain't no way you could possibly be a believer. God can't love you, not after you've done that again. If you're the Son of God." I'm here to tell you today, the moment you ask Jesus in your life, you are a child of God, and you are a child of God today. Your mind might not agree, but I'm telling you, the Word of God declares to me, He is faithful to do the work. He's the author and the finisher of your salvation. He's not going to leave you half-baked. That's how He got you. I'm here to tell you, by the blood of Jesus Christ and by the grace of Almighty God, my name and your name has been written in the Lamb's Book of Life. I'm looking forward to walking streets of gold, walking with Jesus and talking with Jesus and telling Him all my sorrows. And I'm talking to Him about you name by name. See, the wilderness, there was a war. And when Jesus completed that 40-day fast, tempted of the devil, it's only recorded a few times, but for 40 days tempted of the devil, the angels came and ministered to him. If you'll remain faithful in faith and just keep speaking the promises of God, the angels, the messengers of the heirs of salvation will minister refreshing to you. Well, we can just fast forward. Jesus lives his life, going about healing all that are oppressed of the devil. His time has now come. Judas is gone to sell his soul for silver. And Jesus and his remaining disciples go to the garden. We sing a song I did growing up. I come to the garden alone. Jesus went to the garden, told his disciples to pray, and he went just a little ways away, and he knelt and began to pray. And the Bible tells us in Luke 22 that he began to agonize, "Father, not my will, but thy will be done." Maybe that's a prayer you need to pray. Not my will, Father, but thy will be done. And he began to pray in such grievous prayer, such burdensome prayer, that he began to sweat drops of blood. And he gets up and he goes and he finds his disciples, his followers, asleep. In the garden, Satan comes. Mel Gibson depicted that in The Passion of the Christ. How Satan comes. "You don't have to do this. Remember, I told you back in the wilderness, now we're in the garden. You don't have to do this. I can give you all this. Come on, you can take the shortcut. You can get rich quick." It says in verse 44, "And being in agony, he prayed more earnestly, and his sweat was as it were great drops of blood falling down to the ground." Well, then we know the story, how he was betrayed, nailed to a cross. There on the cross, they walked by wagging their heads. "If you're the Son of God, why don't you come down?" The Bible says he could have called upon legions of angels, but he didn't. You know why? Because of you. Because of the lost. He came that anyone who sincerely desires a relationship with God can call upon the name of the Lord. And his great grace and mercy is more than enough. There on the cross, Galatians tells us, Paul, writing by the Holy Spirit, says, "Christ has redeemed us." It was on the cross that the seed bruised the head of the devil.
Hi, I'm Perry Black right here at Destined Wind TV, and I want to say thank you for watching our program. You know, we'd love to connect with you, and one way you can do that is join us right here at Family Church Bryant on Sunday morning or on Wednesday night. As you well know, we teach straight from the Word of God with a touch of humor to make the medicine go down. You know, we believe here at Family Church, a church alive is worth the drive. And if you're not connected with a local church, then why don't you visit us? Information right here on the screen. Until then, I'll see you right here at Destined to Win TV. God bless.